Merci d'être venu ici aujourd'hui. Je travaille avec Intaparas, une organisation de justice sociale internationale qui œuvre de par le monde avec des organisations militantes et des mouvements sociaux. Intaparas travaille depuis 25 ans auprès de la société civile ethnique en Birmanie, surtout dans des régions de conflits armés, y compris des organisations Rohingyas et celles qui promeuvent les droits des Rohingyas. I use the term ethnic civil society because close to half of Burma's population identifies as minority ethnic nationalities. Outside of Burma, people think of its struggles as only for democracy, but there is an even longer struggle for ethnic self-determination, for an inclusive and federal democracy. The backdrop of these intertwined struggles is absolutely central to understanding the Rohingya crisis today. The crisis is not an anomalous problem that bedevils a budding democracy or a military overreaction to a terrorist threat. It is a continuation of a pattern of military violence used against civilians to control territory and remove any resistance. These are not just historic patterns, but current. Since 2011, for instance, the Tatmadaw has been attacking civilians in Kachin and Northern Shan states, while the elected government has denied military atrocities and systematically blocked international aid to displaced people, just as it is doing to the Rohingya. The face of the country has changed from military to civilian, but the pattern remains the same. I recently traveled to Bangladesh with my colleague, Kevin Malseed, where we were hosted by a Rohingya partner. In the middle of camps where flimsy shelters stretched for kilometers in a cyclone zone, we spoke with people who had walked for days to reach safety. I met with women who had birthed babies in these tiny dirt floor structures. I heard stories of relatives beheaded, villages burned, friends shot. I comforted a Rohingya colleague who was reeling after she had heard graphic accounts of gang rape leading to death and of sexualized torture. We have heard estimations of 70,000 pregnancies due to rape, though the reality is that we don't know the number. We don't yet know the staggering scope of all the scars that survivors will bear. But everyone I spoke with in refugee camps said, at least here we can sleep at night without fear of being shot. The thought that the women, men, and children that I met, and hundreds of thousands of like them, could soon be forced back to Burma without a safe zone, without citizenship, without international protection, without livelihoods or freedom of movement seems inconceivable. On that same trip, we met with Karen ethnic refugees living in Thailand who spoke of their fear of moving back to their homes in eastern Burma, where militarization has increased despite a ceasefire. We met with independent journalists who fear arrest under repressive laws, activists who face harassment merely for releasing reports, and ethnic participants to the peace process who recounted its increasing breakdown. All of this has worsened since the election, not improved. Make no mistake, the Rohingya crisis is the signal flare that Burma's democratic transition is in a U-turn. In Canada, we hear Aung San Suu Kyi has no power to act, that she's been silent. But she hasn't been silent. She has been vocal and complicit. She has threatened to have anyone, including journalists, arrested if they express any sympathy for the Rohingya, while labeling reports of human rights abuses as fake news and fake rape. Her top aide uses Burmese language social media accounts to spread hate speech and to refer to Rohingyas as fleas. While Aung San Suu Kyi doesn't control the military, she heads an ultra-hierarchical political power party that has a supermajority in both houses of parliament and an alliance with the military that seemingly grows stronger by the day. This means that her party can pass or repeal any law they want except for amending the constitution without even having military support. The military regime has spent decades cultivating hatred towards the Rohingya, and now the current government is using this same toxic mix of xenophobia and racism to entrench its own power by attacking a hated other. We see clear and worrying signs of a slide towards dictatorship. Aung San Suu Kyi is no longer Asia's Nelson Mandela. She's becoming its Robert Mugabe. The time to act is overdue. The Burmese government reports that repatriation camps will be built within a month, which will inevitably be deemed as the only safe place for returnees to live. There are already internment camps that have warehoused thousands of Rohingya since 2012. The government has blocked them from receiving humanitarian aid, and the people there are slowly wasting away. Meanwhile, burned land becomes government property by law, and redevelopment of Northern Arakan State has already begun without the Rohingya. Intaparas is calling on Canada to advocate for an international arms embargo, to impose targeted sanctions on military-related sectors, as well as asset freezes and travel bans against military and government leaders, and to accept more Rohingya refugees to Canada. Une réponse vigoureuse de la part de la communauté internationale est attendue depuis longtemps. Le Canada a une responsabilité morale d'agir vite. Merci.